The funeral of Pope John Paul II on April the 8th, 2005, contributed in a truly unique way to the advancement of papocentric globalism, as this has been systematically cultivated by Roman Catholic ecumenism since 1965. In that year, four decades ago, the ecumenists of the Fanar and of the Vatican performed the mutual lifting of the anathemas of 1054. By that act of lifting the anathemas, the error of heresy was equated with the truth of orthodoxy, and a new ecclesiological reality was inaugurated. Since then, the Orthodox ecumenists have steadily become estranged from the ecclesiastical Catholicity of orthodoxy and have contributed in deed and word to the triumph of papocentric globalism at both the inter-Christian and interfaith levels, as happened again at the 20th Meeting of Religions for Peace in September of 2005 in Lyon, France. St. Peter's Square in Rome, where the funeral service of Pope John Paul II was held, became the unerring witness of this triumph of papocentric globalism. The funeral of the Pope was characterized as a global event, in that at least 2 billion viewers, one-third of the world, watched it, and more than 4 million pilgrims gathered in Rome. This spectacular funeral service turned into a worldwide meeting of people of every religion and nationality. Rome became once again the center of the world. The funeral of Karol Wojtyla brought together, as perhaps never before in recent years, Christians, people of other religions, and people of goodwill who do not have any particular creed. In fact, it was an unprecedented assembly of public figures. Among the 2,500 representatives of states and religions were 4 kings, 5 queens, and at least 70 presidents and prime ministers who were present at the ceremony paying tribute to the Pope. As has been written, never at any other time in the history of mankind has so great and so completely spontaneous a crowd gathered to express its love and respect for someone who, even in death, has continued to shed his radiance, urbi et orbi. Unfortunately, for the first time since the tragic Great Schism of 1054, Orthodox primates and delegates took part in such a global meeting in Rome for the funeral of a heretical pope, even though heretical papism has not at all retracted any of its multifarious errors. Forty-seven representatives of each of the local Orthodox churches, including 3 primates, those of Constantinople, Athens and Tirana, and 26 hierarchs prayed together around the Pope's coffin.
Μας ο Θεός κατά το μέγελιο σου δεόμεθα σου επακούσον και λέησον.
Κύριε ελέησον, Κύριε ελέησον, Κύριε
Preghiamo ancora per il riposo dell'anima di questo servo di Dio, il Padre e Vescovo nostro Giovanni. Di peccato volontario o involontario.
Κύριε ελέησον, Κύριε ελέησον.
Is it possible for those shepherds who so crassly assault Orthodox Catholicity and openly contribute to the advancement of papocentric globalism to remain united with all the saints?
Annuncio vobis gaudium magnum. Habemus papam.
Alienation of the Orthodox ecumenists and the now entrenched new ecclesiological reality are sedulously impelling us to forget the tragic truth that the institution of the papacy constitutes the greatest heresy, one which perverts the dogma of the Church. Thus, the Orthodox ecumenists are not following the Holy Fathers when they participate in various ways in the enhancement of papocentric globalism.
Il discorso si fa pieno di affetto anche nel saluto che rivolgo a tutti coloro che rinati nel sacramento del battesimo non sono ancora in piena comunione con noi. E da voi, fratelli del popolo ebraico, cui siamo legati da un grande patrimonio spirituale comune che affonda le sue radici nelle irrevocabili promesse di Dio.
On the 24th of April 2005, the episcopate of the new Pope, Benedict XVI, was officially inaugurated. Present at his enthronement were Orthodox ecumenists who cooperated for the umpteenth time in promoting the institution of the pan-heretical papacy. The Vatican, a state of half a square kilometer, was exalted yet again to a superstate and a superpower whose diplomatic relations extend to 174 countries. However, the ecumenists should not have forgotten that the new Pope, as Cardinal Ratzinger, endorsed in 2000 the declaration Dominus Iesus, which underscored with particular emphasis and clarity that there exists a single Church of Christ which subsists in the Catholic Church, governed by the successor of Peter and by the bishops in communion with him. Although Pope Benedict XVI presents himself as moderate and sympathetic to church union, in the end, however, he shows himself to be duplicitous. This was demonstrated exactly 2 months after his enthronement. On the 29th of June 2005, a delegation of ecumenists from Constantinople, headed by Metropolitan John Ziziulus of Pergamon, took part in Rome's patronal feast.
Un saluto cordiale rivolgo con affetto anche alla delegazione del Patriarca Ecumenico di Costantinopoli, venuta per questa speciale circostanza.
The new Pope, addressing the crowds that had inundated St. Peter's Square, and also the Orthodox, who unfortunately were present there and praying together with him, was absolutely clear in his proclamation of heretical papocentric globalism.
Quale vescovo di Roma, il Papa svolge un servizio unico e indispensabile alla Chiesa universale. È il perpetuo e visibile principio e fondamento dell'unità dei vescovi e tutti i fedeli. A partire poi dal duplice evento del martirio di Pietro e di Paolo, tutte le chiese incominciarono a guardare a quella di Roma come al punto di riferimento centrale per l'unità dottrinale e pastorale.
However, the following day, at a special audience with a delegation from the Fanar, Pope Benedict used a different kind of language, the ambiguities of which are reminiscent of the typical and now familiar diplomatic language of ecumenical dialogues and the so-called theology of love. How on earth can the ecumenists exist within the realm of Orthodox Catholicity when by their silence they allow the Pope to mock them and at the same time to promote his heresy, which is hateful to God? On April the 8th, 2005, that is to say, exactly 13 days after the second Sunday of Great Lent, when the memory of St. Gregory Palamas is honoured and we highlight his anti-papist theology, the Orthodox ecumenist took part, by way of joint prayers, in the funeral of Pope John Paul II. The ecumenist primates prayed in precisely these words: "May the Lord grant him repose with his saints, who radiate the light of the cross and resurrection of Christ to the whole world." It is now beyond question that the long-standing cultivation of ecumenism, centering on Geneva and the Vatican, has shaped and established de facto a new ecclesiological reality, as this is perceived and portrayed by the leaders of the World Council of Churches when they assert that all of us Christians, regardless of dogmatic differences, are one in Christ by virtue of our common baptism, and this invisible unity of ours must become visible. These heretical views were set forth before the new Pope, Benedict, in June of 2005 by the General Secretary of the World Council of Churches, Samuel Kobia, in the presence of Orthodox ecumenists. Participation in the Geneva-based World Council and collaboration with Papocentric Globalism, along with adoption of the heresy of the invisible church, have led the innovating ecumenists outside Orthodox Catholicity and far away from communion with the saints, with very grave soteriological repercussions, to be sure. Now is the judgment. In the face of this apostasy, the anti-ecumenists in resistance discern with agony the ever-widening chasm between Orthodox ecumenists and Orthodox who adhere to patristic tradition.